Tens of years ago, it was common to add a practical anti-piracy protection to your software, something like selecting a certain symbol on a specific page of the manual. If you didn't have the manual and somehow got a copy of the game, you were in trouble. Just like here in Prince of Persia 2. This kind of protection is obsolete by today's standard. If nothing else, you can easily find the needed information on the internet. But it's still fascinating. So let's take a look at how to analyze this system and uncover another interesting piece of computer science knowledge. Quick disclaimer, this video is for educational purposes only. Please do not pirate software or engage in any illegal activity. I'll be using DOSBox X for debugging and WinMerge for file comparison. Oh, and there's going to be a lot of blur on the screen, just to stay on the safe side. Hopefully. If you acquire a copy of Prince of Persia 2 from some questionable source, it's probably already cracked to bypass the protection. The crack like that may consist of just 3 bytes. I'm not going to show you exactly what's changed or where, but I can tell you what it means. CA0200 translates to redfar0002. It pops a 4-byte file return address, 2-byte code segment, and 2-byte instruction pointer from the stack and jumps to that address. Then it adjusts the stack pointer by adding the specific value, in this case 2 bytes, effectively discarding 2 extra bytes from the stack. Simply standard way for a function to return to its caller while simultaneously cleaning up 2-byte argument that was passed to it. It's called the Pascal calling convention. Did you call the function that checks for valid symbol input? Good, let me just return immediately instead, because there might be an interrupt 21 that would terminate the program right away. But who knows, right? Let's forget about that for now and dig deeper to see what's actually happening under the hood. I've got my original version here, loading into DOSBox X. The first occurrence of the symbol anti-piracy check happens after the second level of the game. Let me quickly go through it, it's always a pleasure. Prince of Persia 1 was something amazing when I was a kid. More than that, it was my main motivation to become a software developer. Being able to make something like that, to understand it, it fueled my curiosity for many years. And then came Prince of Persia 2. Even more fascinating in every way. A true masterpiece for its animations, graphics and storytelling. For me, the first episode will always be the most influential, but I have never-ending respect for the second one. And honestly, for everything ever titled Prince of Persia on any platform. Here we are, standing in front of the cave. I don't want to spoil the solution to this puzzle, so let's rewind a bit. Now, when the cave opens, we are about to trigger the main reason you are watching this video. We have 10 symbols and the game asks us which one appears on the specific page of the manual. If I choose the wrong one 3 times, the game quits. Before showing you that, let me fail twice and save the state in those books, so we can easily jump back to the perfect moment. As you can see, there's a string. Let's quickly jump into IDA, GIDRA, or in this case Binary Ninja to take a look. The string is there, but it's not referenced anywhere. That's not surprising since current position is determined at runtime. Because that won't help us, we'll try something else, figuring out where the currently selected symbol is stored. I assume there should be a byte whose value changes right after any directional arrow is pressed. Because there's a yellow border around the currently selected symbol, the symbol itself is probably updated in memory after each key press. Good place to look is the data segment of our file, marked by DS register. It would be tedious to check everything visually and hope for the best, so we'll use a memory dump. This dumps all bytes from memory to a file. We can choose between text and binary output. I will go with binary here. Memdump bin of segment DS, starting at offset 0, covering everything, 64 kilobytes. It might be overkill, but we can afford it, so why not? I'll create 3 dumps, each after changing the symbol. Hopefully, we'll see a byte changing from 1 to 2 to 3, or possibly from 0 to 1 to 2, depending on the indexing logic. Let's jump to WinMerge. There aren't many differences between them, which is good. And look at this, I think we found our candidate, a byte at offset 7FDA. Prince of Persia 2 is a 16-bit game, so addressing is done using 2 bytes. It's not much, so there's an extension. A segment with 2 bytes determined at the runtime, and the 2-byte offset within that segment. There's a lot of interesting information hidden in every MS-DOS header. We can look at it another time. But for now, focus on this, 4D and 5A. Those are the hexadecimal codes for the letters M and Z. Do you know what it means and why it's there? They are initials of Mark Zbikowski, one of the leading developers of MS-DOS. By the way, if you are interested in the explanation of what these seemingly random numbers are and how the CPU works with them, I leave a link to another video of mine in the description. let's put our byte of interest front and center using DDS7FDA. If our assumption is correct, we should see its value changing based on the currently selected symbol. And look at that. Beautiful. Now that we know where the information we are interested in is stored, we can set a notification in case something tries to access it. That something could be system checking its correctness. Let's do that using BPM 3958-7FDA-R. This command sets a hardware breakpoint. It uses the CPU's debug registers to watch a specific memory address for access, with R meaning read. It basically says, watch this memory location. If anything tries to read from it, stop immediately. Pressing F5 resumes the run. Let's choose the wrong symbol and step over using F10. I'm looking for a comparison, jump, maybe even a call to another function. I'll be a little brief here on purpose. Jumps are like if statements. We are searching for a fork that decides whether the symbol is right or not. Comparisons are related as they often precede jumps by setting key flags. Function call redirects the flow to other parts. And here we are, an interrupt. The program ends, prints the string, and that's it. What we can do now is run two instances of DOSBox eggs, one for successful run and the other for a failed one. Breaking at the same place and going line by line in both, we eventually reach this spot. The DOSBox debugger even gives us a hint. For a successful symbol identification, we jump away. For an invalid one, we continue. There are several ways to confirm we found the right place, and in this case, I'll simply invert the if statement logic. Patch instruction 75 to 74. To verify our assumptions, I'll choose an inverted symbol, and as expected, the test passes. There's a lot more we could discuss and explore, but I'll stop right here. I hope you learned something new and interesting. Thanks for watching. If you like what you saw, don't forget to hit that subscribe button to see more in the future. See you next time.